Good morning. It's good to see you today. I hope that you're doing well and excited to be here in the house of the Lord today. Let's stand together. Let's join our hearts in worship and sing to our God today.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed.
Fellowship, shake somebody's hand this morning. As you make your way back to your seat, remain standing. I'm thankful for the victory that we have in Jesus Christ today. Because of His shed blood for us, He reached down and He saved us. And we can be thankful for that today. Let's rejoice in that fact and sing to our God.
I heard an
I'm not afraid to
let the Lord know today. Amen. Remain standing at this time.
Amen. Good to see you this morning. You got the victory today? I sure hope so. And there's only one place to find victory, and that is in Jesus Christ. And I hope you found the victory in Him today. Good to see you. Looking forward to ministering the word to you in just a moment, but glad to be together on God's day, worshiping our Lord today. And I hope that you've come prepared to worship Him. I hope you've come prepared to give. And God's been good to us. And so I pray that you will. Let's pray. And let's ask the Lord's blessing on this offering. Brother Eddie Collins, lead us in prayer.
Things in this world that claim to be the salvation, that you can have peace and satisfaction in those things, but there is only one Savior, and that Savior is Jesus Christ. Let's rejoice in that fact today and sing to Him, worshiping Him.
My hope is found in the living God, who is the Savior of all. Savior, He is
Amen. Great singing today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much, God, that you are our Savior. God, and in a world where there are other things claiming to bring us salvation from whatever our situation is in life, God, we know that you are the only one who can truly satisfy and truly save us. God, you did the ultimate thing by paying the price for our sin so we could be saved from our sin. God, thank you for caring for us in the little things that we go through in life. And God, thank you for caring for us for the greatest thing. God, we love you so much for all that you do for us. God, we pray that you would speak to our hearts today and minister to us as we listen to your word. We pray all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good to see you today. Take your Bibles, turn to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 3. This will be our last week in chapter 3. We'll be moving on to chapter 4 next week as we continue our series in the book of 1 Corinthians. And let me say this, as we are going through a series like this, there is a lack of focus in the church as a whole when it comes to the Word of God and the preaching of God's Word. Some think it is silly to actually go through a series of an entire book or to try to systematically go through God's Word. Some think it's silly to put more emphasis on a verse-by-verse approach than to give you a topic or the most popular theme of our culture. And I want you to know this, and know this very, very clearly, that nothing will give you more strength, nothing will give you more hope, and nothing will give you more answers than simply the Word of God. And so we need to make sure we understand that a focus on God's Word, not what's popular to preach on, but a focus on God's Word is valuable to your Christian life. And as we are going through these series like this, which will be a long series, we need to be mindful that this is a letter that was written by a man of God under the inspiration of a holy God to a church. Now, what could be more applicable in the life of a church than to be able to systematically and section by section, truth by truth, theme by theme, be able to go through a letter that was written to a church, was written by a man of God who was under the full inspiration of the Holy Spirit? That just makes sense to me, right? And so I hope that you relish and cherish the opportunity to be able to walk through certain portions of Scripture like this. And I hope it'll be a help to you. This morning, for the last 2,000 years plus, whether young or old, educated, uneducated, skilled, unskilled, funny, serious, whether ugly or good looking, you figure out what category you're in, creative, boring, rich, poor, whether they have been in the church, in America, or across the globe, there is one theme that unites us, and that is the mission of Jesus Christ. There is one thing that unites us, and that is the cross of Jesus Christ. And yet, ironically, the greatest hindrance to building God's people are normally God's people themselves. The Corinthian church is a building project gone wild. It was full of a lot of sinful things. Mainly what we have focused on thus far is division. See, everyone was claiming spiritual enlightenment and building however and whenever and whatever they wanted to. At the heart of that division was pride. They each think that they are more right or more spiritual or more elite or better than the next person. Everyone
there's boasting, and we see it even today, boasting about their own greatness and attach themselves to a different leader, whether it was Paul, the planner, whether it was Apollos, the teacher, whether it was Peter, the leader, or even some, just simply Jesus. Each felt like they were working for God, but they were really working for themselves. They felt like they were trying to build. What they didn't realize was they were actually destroying. What was happening was God was displeased, and things needed to be addressed. At the core of this division was an identity crisis. They really didn't know who they belonged to. It's stated in chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3. You can tell what is important to a person by what consumes their conversation. I can tell what is important to at least these first three chapters in the book of 1 Corinthians because Paul mentions it over and over and over and over again that you are in the middle of an identity crisis and it is causing the church great harm. Some of you say, well, I belong to Paul. And Paul kept saying, none of you belong to me. Some say, well, I am of Apollos. Others, I am of Cephas. There was a great identity problem. See, division in their church was caused by an issue of identity in the individual, not identity in Christ. Please understand this today. Your identity can never be in another person. Your identity can never be in a denomination. Your identity can never be found in a church. Your identity cannot be found in your last name. True identity comes in Jesus Christ alone. It comes in Jesus Christ alone. As people, we cannot stop thinking about ourselves. We're always trying to feel better about ourselves. We try to feel like we are somebody, trying to prove that we have value. And because we are so self-concerned, we don't concern ourselves with others. More than that, we are so self-centered that our self-centeredness works against unity, a unity that the Bible has been promoting to us for months. This is because our sense of identity is often only satisfied through comparison with other people. Have you ever done that? Like to make yourself feel good about yourself, you always compare yourself to somebody else who isn't quite where you are. We did it as kids. My mom and dad would come down hard on me, and what was funny is they would compare me to one of the good kids. Why can't you be more like Ian? Right? And yet sometime in that debate, I would bring up a bad kid. And I'm like, well, at least I'm not like this guy. And they're like, look, I don't care about your friends. Well, you cared about Ian. Right? But we get in that where we compare ourselves to each other to make ourselves feel better. We compare ourselves to who's more blessed or who's more gifted or who's more fortunate or who feels better or sometimes even who feels worse where you just don't know what I'm going through. And it's all a self-concern and a self-centeredness that is birthed out of pride, and it causes division. In every walk of life, it will cause division. And it was. And yet we read here again, as we close these thoughts of this chapter, beginning in verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God? See, I think there are two elements that we seem to fight against in this day we live. There's the element of people that are trying to make themselves look better than everybody else. And then there's the element of those people that are trying to make themselves look like they're going through a lot worse than everybody else. And again, it all comes from self-concern and self-centeredness. It was C.S. Lewis that said it this way about pride. And he said, I restate to you that God hates pride. He said, pride is not the pleasure of having more as much as it is the pleasure of having more than the next person. And making sure that we are exalted. And so there are those that look like, I want to be exalted, but then there are those that just want to be abased. And well, I'm just going through more than anybody else has ever gone through. Nobody knows how I feel. And the Bible says there's no temptation given to you. You have never gone through anything that somebody else hadn't gone through. And so here he's telling this church, you've got this arrogance and this boasting, and then you've got this element of being abased. And he said, I want to remind you of something. You are the temple of God. Know you that you're the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. If you're here today and you are a Christian, you know if you die today, you are on your way to heaven just as loud as you can. I want you to give me a good hearty amen. Amen. You are the temple of God. The Spirit of God dwells in you. If any man defile, verse 17, the temple of God, him shall God destroy or punish. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Let no man deceive himself. If any among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool. Listen to me. It is better to be a fool in the world's eyes than a fool in God's eyes. Let him become a fool that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. Therefore, let no man glory or literally boast in men. For all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or things present or things to come. All are yours. And then notice the next statement. And ye are Christ. I want you to know something this morning. You belong to Jesus. You belong to Jesus. Now, in that very simple statement, I want to make just three observations from our text about this truth. That we are His. You belong. First of all, I want you to see it as a positional truth. A positional truth. What do you mean that I belong to Jesus? You belong to Jesus in position. If you're saved today, if you've accepted by faith Jesus Christ and received His gift of salvation, you are sons and daughters of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you have been adopted into this family. Like God made a choice, as we'll talk about in a moment, to send His Son Jesus so that you and I could have an opportunity to be His children. It's not of our works. Did you hear that? It is not of our works that we are adopted. It is by the works of Jesus Christ. Amen? And He's adopted us. I mentioned on Wednesday, and I just felt so impressed last night to mention it in even more detail because I believe it drives this truth home. The Bible says in verse number 16, know ye not that you are the temple of God, that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. You are His son and you are His daughter. Listen to me. In Luke chapter 15, and I thought about this so much since our reading last week, the picture of the prodigal son coming back to the father. And then many of us can understand those times of being away from God. In fact, I was reading last night about how different the two sons were. In that story, and I'm sure we're all familiar with that story, the younger son left home, the older son stayed home. The younger son was a prodigal or wasteful. The older son was productive. He was a worker. The younger son lost in his inheritance. The older son continued to build his inheritance. The younger son did not any longer feel worthy to be the father's, to have his father's blessings. The older son did. The younger realized his sin. The older felt his righteousness. The younger repented, and the older resented. It's just a fabulous story of so on so many fronts. But the prodigal, the younger son, who left with the father, half the father's inheritance when he was in the world and lost everything. And then there was a famine in the land and he found himself eating with the pigs. And he realized, man, I can go back to my father's house. I can just become one of his servants. I can just acknowledge what I've done. And I can just go work for him. I would be much better off living on the bottom of the servant totem pole in my father's house than living in the pig pen of the world. And by the way, there's a truth there. That the smallest job in the kingdom of God is still greater than anything Satan has for you. And so what did he do? He arose and he went back to his father's house. And the Bible says in Luke chapter 15 that when his father saw him a great way off, he ran to him. And he embraced him. He had compassion on him. He fell on him. He kissed him. And then the son begins to repent. Father, I've sinned against you, and I've sinned against God, and I'm no longer to be called a servant, or a son rather, but I'm only worthy of being a servant. Now listen to this. The father never addresses that. He only proves by action what the son was. And it goes back to this point of you, this positional truth of you being a son and daughter of Jesus Christ. No matter what you've done, no matter where you are, you can come to Jesus Christ, and you can become his son and daughter today. Because here's the son who comes back and says, I'm only worthy to be a servant. And the father proves to him, you're not a servant, you're my son. He gives him a robe. In fact, the Bible says the best robe he placed on him. The father was telling, and you need to hear this, the father was telling the prodigal, as all observers, that his position as a son was being fully restored. It was an immediate demonstration of complete approval and love and covering and mercy. In addition, everyone was witnessing the father transfer of the prime inheritance from his eldest son to the youngest son. He told him, go get the best robe. Probably the best robe there still belonged to the older son because the rest that was there was the older boy. And he said, you go get the best robe because I want to make a point. Number one, you're covered. Number two, you're forgiven. Number three, you're loved. And here's a picture of mercy for you. Go get the best robe. Number two, we mentioned on Wednesday, go get a ring. In the ancient world, a ring was not simply a matter of vanity. It was no mere item of excess wealth. A ring carried a great significance to them as an engagement for a wedding or a sign of ownership and position. He said, you go get him a ring, because every time he looks down at his hands, every time I look down at my hand, I'm reminded, like I need to be reminded, right? But I'm reminded that I'm married. Every time somebody sees me, I never take my ring off. Never. Some of you are like, because you can't. Oh, I can get some of that, right? But I never take my ring off. Why? Because I'm not the only one who needs to be reminded. I want everyone to know that I belong to somebody. And he says, you go get a ring and you put on my son's finger, because every time he looks down at his hands, I want him to be reminded that he belongs. He belongs. He said, go get sandals. This is the one I didn't really spend a lot of time on Wednesday, but I think you need to hear this. Go get sandals for his feet. See, when shoes were taken off, it was a sign of mourning. You could go back to when Ezekiel's wife dies and God says, do not weep. Do not take off your shoes. In those times when they would put sackcloth and ashes on, you can go back to when David, after Absalom died, the Bible says that David went weeping and covered his head and walked without sandals and walked barefooted. Why? It was a sign of grief. It was a sign of mourning. When captives were taken as prisoners of war, to add insult to injury, their shoes were taken away. Isaiah was commanded by God to walk barefoot for 3 years as a symbol of the judgment that awaited the nation of Judah. But the returning son, in his sorrow and in his shame and in his grief, coming no doubt without shoes and dirty and nasty, here comes a son, and his dad said, get him the best robe, because he's been covered and he's loved and there's mercy. Get him a ring, because I want him to be reminded that every time he looks down his head, he knows he belongs. He's not a servant, he's a son. But you get him the shoes, because I want him to know he doesn't have to mourn anymore. The sadness is over. I like this. Once captives were taken back by their own forces, one of the first things that they would do is give them shoes to remind them that you're home. You're home. And then he said, kill the fatted calf. The fatted calf was killed only on special occasions. And this qualified a special occasion. No longer would this son have to wish for the pig's feed. Now he has been restored at the Father's table and can eat till his heart's content. Listen to me. Today you're here. It doesn't matter what you've done. You belong to Jesus Christ. If you've never been saved, you can belong to Jesus Christ. When he said, and ye are Christ, it's a positional truth. It's a positional truth. Secondly and quickly, it's a possessional truth. See, not only does it mean, as I belong to Christ, that I'm his son, but it also means, in a sense, that I am his possession. That know ye that you are the temple of God, that the Spirit of God lives in you. The verses that he speaks to after that, he talks about self-centeredness. He talks about self-concern. He said, let no man be boasting in men. You are Christ. He said, notice verse 22, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or things present or things to come, they're all yours. And you are Christ. It was a possession. I belong to Christ. This is what he says later in this letter. Chapter 6, verse 19, Paul says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God? He says, and you are not your own, for you were bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, listen, which are God's. You say, well, wait a minute. What do you mean that I'm God's? How can he say that I'm his? Number one, he created you. But then number two, he purchased you. Like, you are doubly his. Do we understand that? We are doubly his because he created us and then he purchased us. You say, what did he purchase us with? He purchased you with a price. You need to hear this and hear this well. When I go shopping, no matter what store it is, I make a beeline to the clearance section. My wife will tell you, no matter what the store is. You say, well, not every store has a clearance section. Yes, they do. Every store. And it's almost like gravity. If I were just like to just kind of like allow gravity to take over, I would just fall right to the ground because gravity just pulls you down. The same is true with me in clearance sections. There's like a gravity. I'm just pulled to those. And I like to buy stuff cheap. And truth is, I'll go to some of these sales, even like at Belk, when they're like it's 50% off, an extra 30% off. Like, that's not good enough for me. Like, by the end of it, I want like 85 or 90% off. That's just me. That's just how I buy stuff, okay? I want you to know something. You need to hear this. God did not buy you off of a clearance rack. He paid the highest price for you with his son, Jesus. You need to hear about this price that Jesus paid. See, the prisoner, speaking of Christ, would be tied to a pillar in this crucifixion process and flogged with sticks and special whips like the cat of nine tails. The Romans' scourging whip had iron balls tied a few inches from the end, and each leather thong on the whip had sharp bones and glass-like material that, because of the weight of the iron on the end of the whip, would wrap around the prisoner. The metal weight served to cause serious bruising and contusions, and the leather on the ends of the whips would cut into the skin. The sheep bones were also made to deepen the lacerations in the skin. After only a few lashes, the depths of the cuts would reach into the muscle tissue. And our Savior was whipped 39 times with that. As each stroke cut across the Master's torn shoulders, small particles of His sacred flesh fell from the knotted leather. The Roman soldiers first whipped Jesus back, and as they would practice, then they would turn him over and they would whip his chest, and then they would proceed to turn him back over and whip his back, to only turn him back over and whip his chest. The physical effects of this beating went far beyond considerable pain and inflicted. When the flesh was torn, it was torn on both sides. John Henry Newman reflected when he said, "His death warrant is signed, and who signed it? I did. Those sins of mine were the voices which cried out, 'Crucify him, crucify him.'" That willingness and delight of heart with which I committed them sins was the consent to Pilate to give Jesus over to the cross. At the destination of Calvary, Jesus was first stripped of his garments. There was no loincloth. Roman crucifixion was designed to be gruesome and humiliating, as humiliating as possible. The condemned was stripped naked in order to give him as little dignity as possible. And then there were the nails. Iron spikes that averaged 5 to 7 inches in length were used to nail the arms of the condemned to the crossbeam in the wrist. And although when often you see the palms of Jesus bearing the nails, it was right there in the wrist as they nailed them. And then after the victim is nailed to the cross beam, he would be raised up and attached to the vertical beam, where they would take those nails and they would drive him in his feet to hold him in place. Some have described the hell that Jesus went through for us. One aspect of hell was that he was conscious through all the suffering. One aspect of the hell he went through for us was the blackest darkness that the world had ever seen. As Colossians writes, another aspect of hell, he was surrounded by demonic power. Another aspect of hell was that he was there bearing our sin. And the last aspect was that he was under divine judgment of God because of me. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And it was with his stripes that we are healed. You say, "Well, I'm my own person. I don't belong to anybody." Yes, you do. You belong to Jesus because he paid a high price for us. You are the temple of God. And so there's no room for pride. There's no room for boasting. In the face of the cross, Paul said it this way in Galatians. He said, "God forbid that I should glory saving the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is a positional truth. Ye are Christ is a possessional truth. It's written in the possessive. But finally, and this with this I'm done, it is a positive truth. A positive truth. See, I'm convinced that there's enough evil and discouraging news in the world that we don't always have to hear about it at church. Like, do you understand that the gospel is good news? Amen? It's good news. It's good news. I think the church needs to hear a little good news. The fact that we see some things that God states, sometimes we are naturally negative, and I'm not a naturally negative person, but sometimes even I can see him as something that's naturally negative. For instance, separation. When we talk about the church being separated, come out from among them and be ye separate. We always seem to think that's just a negative thing when it's really not. I remember years ago hearing my dear friend Jeff Jones preach a message about separation, and he preached it in a positive light. And I was 24 years old, and I was a pastor of this church, and it was in that building over there, and I had never heard a message on separation and thinking it was positive. It was positive because he says in verse 17, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing. Listen, and I will receive you. And I will be your father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and my daughters, saith the Lord God Almighty. That's positive. Sometimes we think of holiness as something negative. Even last week, we preached on the judgment seat of Christ, the Bema seat, and we think that that's all negative and it should be sober, but it's not all negative because you understand it is something that you and I can look forward to. I mean, the Apostle Paul said, look, I have fought a good fight. I finished my course. I've kept my faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me on that day. And not to me only, listen to this, but to all those that are looking and longing and loving his glorious appearing. It's something that we can look forward to. The judgment seat of Christ, it doesn't have to be negative. It can be positive. Knowing that you don't belong to you, knowing that we belong to God, is not a negative statement. It's a positive one. It's positive. He said that ye are Christ. That I belong. I mean, lift up your spirit, church. You belong to Jesus. I don't care what your boss says to you tomorrow. I don't care how bad you think it is right now. There are people right now that we know that are going through some of the greatest depressions of their life. And I'm telling you, they need some good news. And it is good news to know that if you're saved, you belong to Jesus. And it's good news to know that if you're lost, you can belong to Jesus. It's good news that I belong to him. And so Paul said, put all this foolishness away. Put all this division away. You don't belong to Paul. You don't belong to Apollos. You don't belong to Cephas. You don't belong to the world. You don't belong to life. You don't belong to death. You belong to Christ. And today I take joy in that, belonging to Jesus. Silly illustration, but it's the best one I could come up with. You ever seen Toy Story? 100 times? I feel like I have too. How many of you have ever seen Toy Story? What's funny is I'm looking at some older folks, and you don't have kids, and your granddad, and you're home watching Toy Story. And that's wonderful to me. It warms my heart. But in Toy Story, there was a new toy that came in to the to Andy's room. It was Buzz Lightyear. And Andy's favorite toy, Woody, was struggling with it because he had always been, you know, the favorite. He was the one that always got to go to the camps, and he was the one that had the posters on the walls. And so here comes Buzz. And so Woody's struggling with that. And so Woody does everything he can to get rid of Buzz. Right? And right now, some of you are smiling because you're reenacting that movie and you want to go home and watch it right now. He gets rid of Buzz because he finally convinces Buzz he's just a toy. Because Buzz thinks he's a space ranger. So now Buzz, toward the end of the movie, is now over at the other neighbor's house, and it's just Mean Kid, and anyway, he's just kind of in the dumps. I'm just a toy. I'm not a space ranger. I'm not trying to protect the galaxy. I'm just a toy. And Woody and the toys go over to try to save Buzz from this mean kid. And one of the things that Woody reminds Buzz of is this. He goes, you know what, maybe you're not a space ranger. Maybe you're a toy, but you're that kid's toy. And there's a scene where Buzz takes his boot and he rubs it off. And there was the kid's name. What was the kid's name? Andy. He said, you may just be a toy, but you still belong to Andy. But you're Andy's toy. Say, preacher, I'm not a whole lot. Well, you know what? Right now, you may not be a whole lot. But you're his, not a whole lot. You're his. And don't you be discouraged. Don't you let the devil let you live in defeat. Don't you let the world just weigh you down so much that you feel worthless and you don't feel like you have a purpose and you don't feel like you have value. You need to know this. You are a son and a daughter of the King of Kings. You belong. I take care of stuff that belongs to me. You belong. And there's no greater truth that I can give you today than to remind you, you are his. Let's bow for prayer. You're here this morning and you say, preacher, however, you say, preacher, God spoke to my heart and I need to be reminded that I belong to him. And all this other stuff that I can get so distracted on, it is irrelevant in light of the fact that I belong to Jesus. And you're here and you say, preacher, thank God that I'm his child. God spoke to my heart. Pray for me. That you, I want you to lift your hand. I want you to lift it high. I want you to leave your seat right now. I want you to get up and get on this altar with these and say, God, thank you. Thank you for the price that was paid for me. Lord, thank you that even in those days when I mess up, I'm not cast out. That I still belong. There may be some here today, you're just down and depressed. Listen, I'm telling you, nothing will lift your spirit more than a good reminder that Jesus paid a price for you so that you could have eternal life. Listen, it's possible today you're here and you'd say, preacher, I'm lost. And right now I don't belong, but I want to. I want to belong. And if Jesus went to the cross and did all those things that you said he did for me, I'm ready to give my life to him. pray for me. If that's you this morning, nobody's looking around. Preacher, I want to belong. I want you to lift up your hand. Preacher, pray for me. I see that hand. God bless you. You can put it down. Now listen. Maybe there were others. We'll wait all day for you. But today, if you want this to be the day that you can belong, I invite you to step out from where you are. I'll meet you right here at the front of this stage. We'll take God's word and show you how you can belong. You want to come? You come on. Lord, thank you for the cross. Which is the power of God unto salvation. Lord, I pray these truths will stay fresh on our mind. As we strive to live for you. We love you. We praise you. For us in Jesus' precious name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Let me give you some quick announcements, okay? We had a basketball game scheduled for tomorrow. It's our first home game. It looks like we're probably going to have to cancel that game tomorrow. For some reasons just out of our control. So this week's events, we've got Tuesday, our Thanksgiving service, which I'm real excited about. And let me encourage you to come ready to praise God. How many of you have something to praise God for? I want you to come Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, just ready to praise God, okay? And then Wednesday, we're feeding our community from 11 to 1. We're going to try to feed 500 people on Wednesday, a Thanksgiving meal. And we need some help. We've got some needs from a food standpoint, from needs from a service standpoint, serving and fellowshipping and cleaning up and setting up. And so if you got any questions about it, I believe there are sign-up lists outside. Are they at the table? There's a table to the right of the Welcome Center that you can get signed up for stuff out there, okay? And please, let's let this be a way that we just love on New Bern again. And let's just try to feed those who are still hurting and those who are in need. I think it'd be a great day. That'll be on Wednesday from 11 to 1. And then make sure that you get your bulletin. There's a lot of announcements in there. The teenagers have got an event on Friday night. And then we've got a Christmas drive in December to help hurricane victims. So just make sure you grab a bulletin today. Let's stand. Listen, I love you, and I'm so thankful for you. I hope you have a great rest of the day. Go find a Sunday school class to get in, okay? You're dismissed. God bless you.